ABC Sports and the College Football Association presents the UCLA Bruins of the Pac-10, Nebraska Cornhuskers of the Big 8. A colorful college football series continuing today out on the plains in Lincoln. Both teams undefeated. Nebraska at the top of the coalition poll. Hello again, everybody. I'm Keith Jackson. Well, injuries have bitten into the front ranks of both these football teams. Nebraska losing its free safety Mike Minter last week. UCLA lost a starting offensive tackle Paul Kennedy to a knee, starting quarterback Carl Greenwood to a broken ankle, and the heralded wide receiver J.J. Stokes is not going to play today. He suffered a thigh injury in the Tennessee game, the opening game of the season, and he's still hurt from it. More on that story. Let's join Lynn Swan.
Keith, thank you very much. I talked with J.J. yesterday and this morning, and there was no miracle last night. He is not going to play in this ball game. What compounded and complicated the injury he suffered on the first pass catch in the UCLA-Tennessee game was the fact he continued to get hit on it. The deep thigh bruise continued to bleed internally. It drained down into the knee and swelled the knee up, completely immobilizing that leg. He still does not have the flexibility. He tried once on Wednesday to work out to see if he could play, but could not. So we will not see him in this ball game because it's important to keep him ready for next week against Washington State, and that is still questionable at this moment. Keith?
All right, Swanee, and so Bob Greasy, here is UCLA in Nebraska's home. What do they do?
Well, you got to be honest with these kids. You're not going to fool them. They are on the road against the number one team, and they have lost their best player. But they do have a good team. They do have a good quarterback, and they do have a good running game. They have nothing to lose. The thing for them to do, the key today, is their offensive line. If they can run the ball and get some time to throw, they can score a lot of points and have a chance to win.
When you play Nebraska, you always talk about stopping the run, which to me is a little bit like talking about stopping the snow in February in Lincoln. You ain't gonna do it.
Well, if Tom Osborne said if he's got one weakness, it's in the balance on his offense. They are number one rushing the ball in the country and near the bottom passing the ball. If UCLA can stop the run and force them to pass, this could be very interesting.
The Sea of Red is in full flow. This is the 10th meeting between these two teams. Nebraska's 1-5. Will kick off to the Nebraska Cornhuskers. Bruins won the toss, deferred to the second half. This is the 196th consecutive home sellout for the Nebraska Cornhuskers. Damon Binning 21 and Clinton Childs 26 are the deep people. It's perfect weather, just enough breeze to knock the ball off the tee, which causes the big crowd to get another breath so they can roar louder when finally foot meets the ball. They play on the rug in Lincoln. Low kick, short hop by Binning, the tailback. Damon Binning pops out of the traffic and runs all the way to the 39-yard line, where the Cornhuskers will have their first snap. Very good field position. Quarterback Tommy Frazier comes out. In the two games this year for Nebraska, his passing has not been his strongest thing. He's completing passes at roughly 42%. However, the running part of his game is very impressive. The quarterback leading the team in rushing average and in scoring. And so here we go with the first snap of the ball game at the 39. First down for Nebraska. UCLA shows the four-man down front. Support on the outside. Actually winds up almost an eight-man front with the backers in tight. And the gain is about 3 yards. Lawrence Phillips is out of Los Angeles. He was a warning last year in the Rose Bowl in a 14-13 victory. Went for 137 yards against UCLA as a freshman. So he gets a chance to see a team from his hometown for the second successive year. He is the I-back number one. Option play. Frazier keeps it, turns it, and will pick up a couple of yards up to about the 44, close to the 45. It is the offensive front of this Nebraska team that is so impressive. Zetiska, Wilkes, Graham, Stye, Wiegert. The two guys on the right side are really something, but they're all good. When you see the power sweep coming around the corner, it's like watching a mountain starting to move.
And those corners for UCLA are small, 5'9", both of them.
It is third down and 5 for the Huskers. Now timeout. Phillips and Frazier were mixed up. They didn't have the kind of formation he wanted. Tommy started to point his back, realized he was running out of time, and spent one of his timeouts. Third down and 5 now. Let's see what the Bruins do defensively. They put 5 men up there as one of the backers steps up, now drops off the line. They're coming out of the shotgun formation. The snap comes back to Frazier. Frazier throws it in the ground. Incomplete forward pass. It'll be fourth down. And so UCLA defensively does what it had hoped to do as Gary Walton had the penetration, got to Tommy Frazier, forced him to dump it, and now Nebraska will have to punt.
Nebraska tried to run a little option, Keith, on four wide receiver. They'd shown pass the last couple of games from that position. That time they run a little option, and UCLA pressure stopped it.
So the young man from Bakersfield, Brian Adams, goes deep for UCLA, waiting for the punt from Darren Erstad, who is from Jamestown, North Dakota. 6 punts this year, almost 48-yard average. Terrific leg on him, whips that thing into the wind. Adams makes the catch at the 11, comes back to the 17, and there the Bruins will go to work short of their 20-yard line. Quite a disparity in field position after a 45-yard punt. Wayne Cook is off to a pretty good start this year, and you can see he's thrown 2 touchdowns, been picked off twice, but he's been a very steady performer, and they're going to need a very steady performance from him today against Nebraska. Bruins are defeating Tennessee by a couple, got by SMU in a very narrow escape. So they haven't exactly blown anybody away, though they did lead Tennessee at one time 18-0 after 3 quarters. So here's your first snap with Sherman Shaw lining up as the deep back. Milliner is your fullback. And it is Shaw with the ball, picking his way in the traffic. He'll pick up about 3 yards up near the 20 before Dwayne Harris brings him down. Sherman Shaw now having a very good start on the year, but the interesting fellow here in this alignment is Mike Nguyen, the Vietnamese youngster, who is getting the start today because J.J. Stokes is injured and can't play. He's not the swiftest, but he has very good hands, and he's a very bright young player. He's a tough guy. He will make the possession catch for you. It is second down, and call it 9. Ball was marked short of the 20. Inside the trap play works for Sherman Shaw a little bit. He got out close to the 25 before Kareem Moss, the strong safety, senior out of Spartanburg, South Carolina, makes the hit on him. The offensive front for UCLA, and this I think is one of the keys, as Bob pointed out, in this ball game. They're good players, all of them. Chad Oberhauser steps in as the starting right tackle, replacing Paul Kennedy, who went down with a knee operation from an injury. Aaron Washington is in the backfield now as they go to the shotgun with the spread, 4 wide outs. Cook looking around, loops it in the air, throws it out of bounds, incomplete. The receiver had broken away, however, from the defender and made the catch, but he was out of bounds. But you see that Nebraska will play a linebacker on a receiver because these guys, the linebacker, used to be defensive backs.
That's exactly right.
So Dumas, Coleman, and Stewart are people that can really run out of those linebacker positions. Kareem Moss and Reggie Ball will go deep for Nebraska, and Darren Shager will step up to punt. Shager had a terrific game punting against Tennessee. He's averaging right at 43 yards per punt, long having been 53, and that was memorable because he knocked it out on the 1-yard line. Almost blocked. Tipped the ball. They can knock him down. No foul. Ball bounces downfield and is returned a little bit. And once again, Nebraska gets very, very good field position at the 40-yard line.
That was Brandon Miles. Yeah.
Baron Miles came flashing in, number 14, and got a piece of the ball. You see the official back there indicate that he tipped it. And if he hits it, then he can go ahead and hit the kicker, and that's what he did. A 39-yard punt and a 2-yard return. A 50-yard line for the University of Nebraska Cornhuskers. Lawrence Phillips is the eye back. This time they put some motion into the thing and give the ball to Phillips, and he finds daylight in the middle. Big, big hole up the middle. It's good for about 12 yards on the carry. CFA College Football on ABC Sports, brought to you by the all-new Chevy Blazer with its exclusive driver control system, coming soon to your local Chevy dealer. Ralston Purina Company of Checkerboard Square. AT&T, we help put your world within reach. And the Optima True Grace Card from American Express. First time today another team has been in the other side of the field. Nebraska first down, UCLA 48-yard line. Ball handed again to Phillips. And Phillips will get it inside the 45 to the 43. Lawrence calls West Covina, California home.
He just go back and take a look at that almost blocked punt for Nebraska. The second man from the bottom of your screen, that's Baron Miles, number 14. Now watch as he starts upfield and then ducks inside of the UCLA blocker. And he just barely got a piece of it. There's Miles. He has blocked three kicks in his career at Nebraska.
As long as you get a piece of the ball, you can run into the kicker. And the official instantly indicated he had gotten a piece of it. Here's the power play to the right side on second down and four, and it'll be down to the 40-yard line. And now let's join John Saunders for his information about the destruction of the day at Penn State.
Well, Keith, you had a chance to see the Nittany Lions last week dominate against USC. Well, they were at it again this week against the Iowa Hawkeyes. The punter, Nick Gallery, has it blocked by Brian Miller. And Phil Yeboah-Cody tumbles on the ball in the end zone, 61-21. Penn State may be the best in the country, Keith.
It would not surprise me. I tell you, they're for real. I was really impressed with them last week. Here is Frazier on an option down the line. Good coverage on the option play, and I think that tells you right now what the Bruins have in mind for Mr. Frazier today. Every time he starts down that line, everybody wearing white's going to jump on him if they can get to it. Donnie Edwards, of course, is a key man in this defensive alignment. He's a linebacker who runs everywhere. Great speed. Had a big play in the Tennessee win. It is now for Nebraska, fourth down and two. Andy Colbert is the youngster who steps into the cornerback position, replacing the injured Carl Greenwood. They're really going to miss Greenwood because he was a big, tough guy to play that corner position, especially in run support. On fourth and two, the Huskers go. And they've got it. And they've got a lot. They're inside the 25, first down at the UCLA 23. Misdirection. It still works. Always has and probably always will.
This play is going to start to the left side. All straight blocking. Watch the huge gap to the right side. And Phillips has great vision, as most good running backs do, and cuts back to the right side. Wiegert is 72. Stye is 66. But watch the block. It's going to come from the top. Muhammad, number 27. That's the wide receiver. Great blocking by their wide receiver.
First pass from Frazier. A hummer to the end zone. Touchdown. Eric Alford. Typical Nebraska possession. They get you a little off balance, a little option, a little misdirection, and then bingo.
From the left side, watch the man on the left side. He's going to go out of your frame and then back in it. Bob Field, the defensive coordinator, said in last year's game, he thought that Nebraska could have taken advantage of the two tight end passing situation a little bit more. They have done it on the second drive for a touchdown here today.
Sealer for the extra point. It is blocked.
Get 2 points out of this.
Right, yeah. Back.
A little late getting started. So Sealer, who has been able to get the ball up so quickly, kick it so high in the air, and all of a sudden he hits a low knuckleball and it's blocked.
A little penetration up the middle on the offensive block.
5-yard face mask.
Against Nebraska. On the tackle of the man who picked up the blocked field goal. Tommy Frazier's career touchdowns responsible for now total 21 rushing and 25 passing.
Take a look up the middle. There's going to be some penetration by one of the UCLA players. Gets his hand up. That ball is just kicked low, though.
Yeah, he just hit it right into the stack.
Yeah, that's just low. Nebraska has scored 12 touchdowns now this year, Keith, and Frazier has had a hand in eight of them.
Phillips gets a good start on the day as well, the I-back, with four carries. He's gone 12 yards, 6 yards, 2, and then 17 on his last carry. And so the Cornhuskers at home jump out to a 6-0 lead. And as usual, we told you, they're sold out. Number 196, their 200th, is going to come October 29 when the Colorado Buffaloes come to town.
Special teams, too, Keith, set that up. For UCLA coming in here, playing the number one team on the road without your best player, you cannot make mistakes on special teams. And although the punt wasn't blocked, it was partially blocked, gave Nebraska good field position. They only had to go a little over 50 yards for that touchdown.
You saw Corey Schlesinger getting a new tape job, the Nebraska fullback. Brian Adams is waiting for the ball, and Derek Ayers is back there with him, number 25. Here is Darren Erstad to kick it off. This kid's really got some leg. I mean, it's a cannon. Into the wind at the goal line. Adams coming up across the 20 and out to about the 23, and the Bruins will go to work from there. Here's Lynn Swan.
Keith, coming into the ballgame, everybody knew what both these teams wanted to do offensively. Take a look at the statistics, the percentage of run versus pass. Nebraska, big offensive line, they're going to run the football. UCLA, a little wit and guile with a balanced attack. What does this mean for Nebraska? Well, the small percentage in passing doesn't mean anything as long as you're efficient, i.e., every play they had so far in this ballgame has been a run with the exception of one, which was a pass for a touchdown. If you can have that kind of success, keep it up.
Bruins started out with a series based on draw plays, which is a basic in their attack.
Nothing new there, right?
No. Now let's see if they change anything. Cook will throw on first down to the sideline. Pass is completed, and he didn't go out of bounds. As a matter of fact, Kevin Jordan almost got loose. And if you give this guy a step, you very seldom are going to catch him. So it's a big play. The Bruins suddenly jump all the way out to the 44-yard line.
It's a nice play for UCLA. Bob Toledo, the new offensive coordinator, calling a play-action pass on first down and getting Jordan and Cook a little bit of confidence. UCLA has a chance to win. Those two guys have to play well.
Pick up of 24 yards, first down, their 44. Tripped up behind the line of scrimmage, Sherman Shaw. Never got started. Florida, Tennessee, big ball game tonight. A lot of folks interested in how that one comes out because Tennessee rebounded with a solid win over Georgia. Right now, the UCLA Bruins in their second possession running a no-huddle offense. They showed this in the opening game, used it some again last week. It wasn't particularly, in fact, UCLA didn't do anything particularly effective for a good long time in the SMU game. Second down and call it 12. Maybe checking here. Out of the no huddle. Pressure coming. Ball is handed away. Given to Sherman Shaw. And he gets the ball across midfield for the first time today. UCLA is on the Nebraska side of the field at the Husker 47-yard line.
UCLA is going to run a lot of draws. Nebraska was blitzing that time, and it was a nice call because they picked up the blitz, and there was a huge space where the linebacker would have been. That's just UCLA's game plan. Going to run a lot of screens and draws.
It's third down and about a yard and a half. Shaw shakes one, gets the first down. The first collision, Sherman Shaw, who's 5'10", 189, a sophomore, he took the blow, dropped his shoulder, and rammed his way to the 45, and that's all they needed for the first.
Shaw has been a pleasant surprise this year. He had both knees scoped last year.
Now we get the spread formation with Milliner joining Cook as he drops back. And you got four wideouts in the ball game. Wayne Cook walking around, checking to make sure everybody's in the right place. First down at the Cornhusker 45. Nebraska leading 6-0 in the first quarter. Hand the ball away to Milliner, and Milliner is cracked down by Stewart, Big Ed Stewart, the graduate student from Chicago, nailed him amidships right about the line of scrimmage.
Stewart is one of those defensive backs that is now playing linebacker. He and Dumas. When UCLA went to four wide receivers that time, Nebraska didn't substitute. They just moved Stewart and Dumas, both XDBs, out over the inside of the slot receivers and said, all right, let's play.
When they told Stewart they wanted him to play linebacker, Ed said, I quit. Then they saw what they were going to do with that linebacker, and he's come on to be one of the best in the country. Cook's pass, got a man, completes the pass down about the 35-yard line and close to a first down, but if the markers are in the right place, he's going to be just a little bit short. And Wayne Cook showed poise on that play.
Yes, he did, Keith, and the offensive line gave him a little bit more time. He was living on borrowed time. He stepped up, but the coverage was pretty good, and with that extra time, he almost picked up the first down.
Adams made the catch in front of Tony Veland. He is the new free safety, replacing Mike Minter, who suffered an in-season-ending knee injury last week. Cook goes back under center on third down and one from the Husker 35. There's contact. Question or not whether or not the UCLA man moved to draw the defender. Bruins moved.
Dead ball. Procedure. Offense.
Steve Juszczyk heading a Big 8 crew. Terry Donahue is either doing a little politicking for the future.
At least.
But one thing, he's disagreeing with what just happened. And so it is third down and six. And they will throw it. No, they won't. Wayne Cook was sacked six times last year by Nebraska in the game at the Rose Bowl, and that's the first time they get to him today.
Well, number 86, Harris, is going to be working against the redshirt freshman Oberhauser right there, who is replacing Paul Kennedy, who was hurt in the game last week. Oberhauser gets beat, and Harris gets the sack.
Moss drops back and Shakers into punt. 5 minutes remaining in the first quarter. Left puts it out of there. It's a good punter. Hangs it up in the breeze. Taken at the 11. Down at the 11. That's good coverage. Got to blow the whistle. The kids won't stop playing if you don't blow the whistle. These two teams had one of the most unusual things I've ever seen last time they played out in the Rose Bowl. It was, what, about 4 years or 5 years ago, I guess it was, when the punt returner took it, rolled over the top of a couple of Bruins, and then ambled and walked for an easy touchdown. The ball is on the 11-yard line, Nebraska end of the field. Huskers lead 6-0 with 4:43 to go in the first quarter. You've got number two, John Livingston, in the ball game for the first time, and Riley Washington, a sophomore out of Chula Vista, California, checks in. They're the wideouts. Lawrence Phillips and Corey Schlesinger are lined up by behind Tommy Frazier now. And the Bruins pull in the linebackers very tight. And they try to wrestle that big fullback down, and there's going to be a gain up to about the 15-yard line. Schlesinger is a 230-pound senior from Duncan, Nebraska. And he looks, walks, talks, and plays like Tom Rathman did when Tom was here.
Yes, he does. He is a tough young man. The fullbacks at Nebraska don't get a lot of carries. But if the option is not working to the outside, that fullback will get some carries and more often than not, some yards.
He got 84 last week. Frazier on an option going down the line. Delivers the ball to Phillips. He almost dropped it. Finds Bayline on the corner. That's what happens on the right side of that line behind Brendan Stye, Zach Wiegert, and Ed Schlesinger through the group. And it's really tough. The gain is out to near the 30, and it's a first down. Phillips now on five carries has 51 yards.
It's not only that line, Keith, that we've talked about, but the tight ends, the fullbacks, and the wide receivers, all excellent blockers.
put it on the 29 for the first down snap and a whistle.
Flag on the play.
Dead ball. False start. Offense.
You saw number 33 on the field. That is Clester Johnson, a junior out of Bellevue, Nebraska, starting ahead of Abdul Muhammad at the wingback position this week. Muhammad's been dinged up a bit all season long. Of course, the wingback in the Nebraska offense is also required to do his fair share of blocking.
He's a wide receiver, but they call him wingback because he blocks so much, number one. And secondly, he lines up in tight, just off of the tight end a lot of times, or in the backfield, and then shifts out like they're doing now.
A fellow named Brinson used to wear that number and play that position, and he was really a tough nut.
Johnny Rogers.
That ball goes right through the hands of Mark Gilman, the tight end. Incomplete forward pass. And Frazier had a lot of sizzle on that one. So it'll be second down and 15 with 3 minutes and 31 seconds to go in the first quarter of play.
There's a look at George Case. He's a nose tackle on this team. He's a junior. Very competitive, very hyper guy. He said last year in this game, he started out the game. He was all excited about playing against Brendan Stye, the offensive guard. But he started the game last year on his hands and knees on the sideline. He was so sick, he was over there throwing up, but cleared up, and he came in and played very well.
Reggie Ball is the wide man at the bottom of the picture. UCLA's defense doesn't know what to do with him. The pass is thrown incomplete, out of bounds. If that pass is on the money, Brendan Holbein might still be running, and Holbein is something of a news item. He went to a party after the ball game last week, and somebody had a gun. He was outside down the road from the party, and a bullet kind of creased him. They said it took some stitches to close it up, but here he is playing today.
It was just a stray bullet. It wasn't fired at him or anything. He wasn't involved with it.
Kind of a hard thing, though, for a wide receiver to take a bullet crease across his table.
Yeah, it used to be that, you know, you have a fight at a party, you just have a fist. Now it's knives and guns.
Frazier's pass on the money. Pass is caught. Good for a first down. It's across the 40. And so they get just enough to move the chains. And that pass was a bullet. And Donnie Edwards is shaken up on the play, and that may be the worst piece of bad news I could bring a UCLA partisan.
There's Case. Let's take a look at the pass protection. This is a drop back pass by Nebraska. You don't see this a whole lot, but they're doing an excellent job of pass protection. And Tommy Frazier just drills it.
But the story is over there on the sidelines, number 23, Donnie Edwards. He is their best linebacker. He is the bell cow of that defensive unit, and he's sitting down on the field, and they can ill afford to lose him, having already lost Greenwood.
They lost their best defensive back for the year last week, Greenwood. They have lost their best player on the team in J.J. Stokes for a couple of games, maybe another game, and now you've got Edwards hurt.
Those are the games we'll have for you next week. You can check your local listings for the game in your area or check your local cable operator to see whether or not he will have something available for you on pay-per-view. Some will give you several games, and some will give you one, and some will give you none. You'll just have to call and check with them. And it's the best price in all of sports.
Terry Donahue cannot believe what's happening to him. The injuries. Edwards had 4.5 sacks last week against SMU. He was their second leading tackler coming into the game today, and hopefully it's just a cramp.
It doesn't look like it. It looks to me like there's more to it than a cramp, the way they're holding on to him. Donnie Edwards at 6'4", 216 pounds, is very, very mobile. He's much like the Nebraska linebackers. He's fully capable of the quickness and agility and the speed to play a defensive back position. But seeing him walking around makes you feel good about things. At the conclusion of today's game, Chevrolet will have its most valuable player of the game award for each team 24th year through the Chevrolet Scholarship Program. $1,000 has been donated to the General Scholarship Fund of each school. He's got to come out of the game. You always have to come out after an injury is taken in your behalf. And Jason Green, a senior, number 91 from West Covina, has gone onto the field to replace him. Jason's a good football player himself, but Donnie Edwards is special football player. All right, Nebraska leading 6-0, 3:11 to go with the football just over the 40-yard line. Tommy Frazier gives it to Lawrence Phillips. Phillips glides along, finds the crack, dives through it. Shane Jasper made the tackle. Back in 1972, the Nebraska Cornhuskers came in against UCLA, ranked number one in the nation. UCLA beat them 20-17. Efren Herrera kicked the field goal to win it. It was Mark Harmon's first game at quarterback for the UCLA Bruins. Right now, Nebraska leads 6-0, and Lawrence Phillips turns the corner with Zach Wiegert in front of him and picks up the first down on the UCLA side of the field at the 44. Now let's join John Saunders again.
Keith, as you know, Terry Bowden has never lost as coach of the Auburn Tigers, but his team was down with under 2 minutes remaining. 3rd and 4, Jamie Howard of LSU is picked off by Brian Robinson. He takes it 41 yards for the touchdown, the third interception for a touchdown in the game, a school record. LSU's marching, though. We'll keep you updated.
LSU's a very, very much improved football team this year.
It's obvious by that score, right?
Playing a lot of babies, too. They're going to get tougher and tougher. Here's Frazier, stops now, looks and rips it. And the pass is incomplete, and that's a very good play by Teddy Lawrence, number 2. So Teddy Lawrence continues to show that he is a very good corner. He was the man who made the play against Tennessee on the opening snap of the ball game to save the touchdown. And here he had Reggie Ball over there, and Reggie got his hands on it, but he knocked it loose.
We're having a meeting of all the small people of the world. Lawrence is only 5'9", Ball is 5'9", a bunch of small people. Wide receiver and cornerback in this ball game for both sides.
It is 2nd down and 10, UCLA 44-yard line. Nebraska leading 6-0 as Frazier goes down the line on the option, pitches to Phillips, and the support was not there. Then on the commitment of the pitch, the UCLA defender made his play, but there was no support behind him.
Yep.
And Phillips will have a first down.
Nebraska has something called their itty-bitty committee, as a matter of fact. These are all wide receivers. And Phillips on that run got a good block from one of these four, because the wide receivers in Nebraska, although they are small, they are good blockers.
34-yard line and a first down. 2 minutes to go in the first quarter. To the fullback Schlesinger. Inside the 10, first and goal at the 7.
You can't forget about the fullback in the Nebraska option. Watch to the right of your screen. The good blocking by Wiegert right there. They don't block 97, that's Ward. They just run past him. Schlesinger has surprising speed.
Donnie Edwards is back on the field defensively for UCLA. 1st down and goal from the 7-yard line. Phillips is the eye back. Schlesinger is hot. Give it to him again. Well, he piles into the middle and moves the stack 2 yards.
This option, Keith, as you know it, forces the defense to play assignment football, very disciplined. You got to cover up for the fullback. Somebody's got to stay at home and make sure that he doesn't have the football. Then you move to the quarterback and the pitch. But you have, first things first, stop the fullback.
Now they break it up. And Phillips is the single back. On 2nd and goal from the 5, Frazier gives it to Phillips. Spins to the 2. Wiggles to the 1, but they won't give him that much. Auburn hangs on to win, or comes back to win against LSU. It was at Auburn. If it had been down in Death Valley, who knows? Ball just inside the two. Third down and goal for Nebraska. They lead it 6-0. They're trying to count another one. The time ticking away here. You've got 15 seconds on the 25-second clock and 22 seconds on the game clock. So this could be the last play of the first quarter. Frazier keeps it. Delivers it. Bobbles it. Touchdown. Walked in. Despite the fact that he almost dropped the ball, he walks in for the touchdown, and it's 12-0.
They got to stay ahead of him and see if he can see any of the blocking. The fullback Schlesinger gets a great block. That's why he can juggle this ball and still have time to get into the end zone untouched. The wide receiver had a block, and the fullback doing a nice job.
Nebraska will go for two now. Try to get it back on track, having had the point after blocked following their first touchdown. Frazier keeps it, wants to throw. Does, and throws it away. So they go 89 yards and 13 plays. Phillips gets the touchdown. 11 seconds remain in the first quarter. They miss both extra points, and it's a 12-0 ball game, Nebraska. Darren Erstad, number 6, will kick it off. Sophomore from Jamestown, had a big summer playing baseball in the Cape Cod League. Drove all night to get to football practice. Brian Adams and Derek Ayers are the deep people for UCLA. This is a big leg right here. That's into the wind, folks.
Let's go back and look at the touchdown. You know it's going to be an option this way. But watch Schlesinger, the fullback, as he's going to come through and get a great block on the safety. The line does their job. Option the in man on the line. Watch the block right there. The wide receiver in the end zone, getting the corner to stay in the end zone. Nobody outside. 13 plays, 89 yards.
UCLA will go with James Milliner at fullback and Darren Washington. At the other running back position, as they shift into the eye, that's Washington, number 30, the deep man, and Wayne Cook's pass. He's got a man on the sidelines, and the pass is slapped away by Leslie Dennis, a redshirt freshman from Bradenton, Florida. And you got a penalty flag thrown over on the sideline. Michigan State out to a 10-0 lead over Notre Dame in the second quarter of play.
Notre Dame must still be hung over.
Yeah, might be.
From last week's shock. That was just a poor throw. The receiver was open.
I think they picked it up.
Non-catchable.
Non-catchable ball, no foul.
That ball was catchable, Keith. He just threw it. He threw it upfield. If he would have thrown it back away from the defensive man, there would have been no problem. But he threw it upfield.
I thought the ball
but
hit him on the hand.
But to say it wasn't catchable.
I thought it hit him on the hand.
It did hit him in the hands.
How the heck could it be uncatchable?
I don't. It certainly was catchable. There may have been some other reason they picked it up.
Second down and 10. Washington's going nowhere. It was Darren Washington that had that big run that sealed the Tennessee victory for them. At that time, he picks up 2 yards. So we played 15 minutes in Lincoln, and the home folks lead by a score of 12-0.
Let's go back and take a look at the first play of this drive for UCLA. This is the out route. The ball is thrown. This is the ball that the official said was uncatchable. He hits him right. The defensive man contacts him there ahead of the ball getting there. That is interference. Here's a flag at the bottom of the screen. Didn't get it out very well, but it was very catchable, and it was interference.
They just missed the call.
Yeah, they missed the call.
No question about it. It is third down and 8 now for UCLA. The ball at the 22-yard line. Out of the shotgun, Wayne Cook has time and hits his man. That's good for a first down. Unless he keeps running backwards.
It was
stood
a first
up on
down.
The 32-yard line and move the chains for the Bruins.
Well, you got a lot of numbers for Nebraska. Total yardage of 159. 121 yards of that rushing. 8 first downs to 2. Nebraska had the ball 3 possessions to only 2 for UCLA. This is their third possession.
Double wide bottom of the picture. Kevin Jordan is down there, and Mike Wynn with him. Wayne Cook wanted to throw, now throws, and it's a bad pass, and it's a bad play. It's a wasted play. Cook should have just kept the ball. He could have picked up 4 or 5 yards, but he had no chance in the world to complete that pass.
Well, it didn't go like it went in practice. I can assure you it was a kind of a fake draw to the right side and a counter coming back, but the defensive end on that side, Donna Jones, played it very well.
Yeah, he had just simply stepped in between Cook and the intended receiver.
Right. He had good containment, which is the good discipline that Charlie McBride, the defensive coordinator, has his people where they should be.
Second down and 10. Nebraska bouncing around on defense. Out of the shotgun. Cook gets his pass off and his man is open. That's Kevin Jordan. He's still alive. He did not go out of bounds. He gets a little help. He gets inside the 20-yard line. Make it the 18. First down, UCLA.
Well, when you blitz, you put your secondary one-on-one, and Nebraska was in a blitz situation. To the right of your screen, that's Jordan, their best receiver, the outstanding receiver. Go out. Now, if you can beat one-on-one, big things are going to happen. Stays in bound or does he? Awfully close.
I'm looking straight down on top of him almost with the binoculars. He did not step out of bounds. Wayne Cook gives the ball to Darren Washington, and Washington is just eaten up. Wayne Harris is having a big ball game at defensive end for Nebraska.
Wayne Harris is a big, rough, and tough defensive end. This is a straight lead play, and the defensive end beat the block. We were eating dinner last night, and our waitress said that Dwayne Harris babysat for her 8- and 9-year-old kids. So he's a good guy.
It is second down and 12 now for UCLA. Cook's pass is away to Jordan down the middle. He's open. Touchdown, UCLA. So they run a wide receiver screen down the middle of the highway, and it goes in for 6.
Let's take a look at it. He's up here. He's going to just slide down here. Now, but watch the offensive lineman go downfield. When you throw the ball behind the line of scrimmage, as this is, the lineman can go downfield. That is true in college ball, but not in professional football.
Extra point try for Bjorn Merton out of the hold of Kevin Walker. It's good. And so, as we start the second quarter of play, with 13:23 remaining in the first half, UCLA Bruins get back into the ball game by a score of 12-7, and we've got a penalty flag on the field.
Illegal participation. Defense. What do you want to do?
So they'll put it onto the kickoff. And the crowd all of a sudden got a little quiet, didn't it? 12-7 ball game. Scoring drive story there, the 20-yard reception by Jordan, but more importantly, Jordan had 70 of the 80 yards in 2 big plays.
Well, that's what happens when your number one receiver is out. J.J. Stokes, the next guy in line, going to catch a lot of balls. Jordan is no slouch by any means.
All right, Merton will kick it off. They put the ball at midfield now after that penalty of illegal participation, which is a 15-yard penalty. And Bjorn shouldn't have any trouble kicking this one into the end zone. Might be a time, though, to hit a squibber down the middle and see who it bounced off of.
Exactly right.
But he knocks it on through into the crowd, and it'll come back to the 20-yard line. And Monday, Craig T. Nelson, I'll have you know, stars in an all-new coach, followed by blue skies, and then Detroit at Dallas. Lions and Cowboys on ABC's NFL Monday Night Football. That's all Monday on ABC.
Scott Mitchell's kind of got him excited up in Detroit, doesn't he?
Yeah, I guess. Clinton Childs lines up at the tie back position. Number 26 has the ball, a junior out of Omaha. He can haul it too. Out to the 45-yard line and a first down. Paul Guidry, the free safety, saved the TD.
It amazes me how these big 300-pound linemen could run. Watch Wiegert and Stey, 72 and 66. 66 Stey is going to pull up, and Wiegert just gets around, and once the back sees the opening, he says, all right, I've been in this convoy long enough. It's time to turn on the speed and say goodbye, and he did.
And he was within 1 foot of going for six. This time, Childs takes it up the middle, picks up 2 yards as Gary Walton gets his second tackle of the ball game, the big junior out of San Diego. George Case, number 59, the nose guard for UCLA, and Grady Stretz actually started the ball game today ahead of Saleh Isaiah. 12-7. Kind of looks like it might be another one of those days. Bruins just kind of hang around.
Nebraska averaging over eight yards every time they run the football.
Childs has got it again. He's got Wiegert in front of him again.
It's the same play. Tom Osborne, who calls the play, says, hey, before they figure out what that play was, let's run that a couple more times.
I'll tell you what, Zach Wiegert took Rod Smalley, and he put poor old Rod all the way up into the stand. Now watch this.
Yeah,
72. Number 72.
That's Stey. He clears out the way. Now, Wiegert's got nobody to block.
Right here, he's going to find somebody.
Now, 10 yards downfield, he didn't have anybody.
And somebody else right behind him. And what happened was Smalley and Wiegert got tangled up after the tackle, and they just kept on rolling. And I'll tell you, that's a mismatch when you're rolling around on the ground with Wiegert. Here's a little quick pop thrown to the left side on the first down play, and the play good for about 7 yards as Clinton Childs, the I-back, catches the ball. Two of the tailbacks, Damon Benning, 21, and Clinton Childs, 26, are both from Omaha. Benning a sophomore and Childs a junior. They, generally speaking, will keep the best players at home in the state of Nebraska.
The thing they really keep at home is their big linemen.
That's, yeah, they do.
They've had they've had 6 Outland and 3 Lombardi winners, and that goes predominantly to offensive and defensive linemen.
It's second down and 3 from the UCLA 25. Makavica is in at fullback. Frazier's pass. Hummer caught. Number 5, Brendan Holbein. That's at the 18-yard line. Here's Swanee.
Keith, you and Bob are talking about the size of Nebraska's offensive line. You know, it's not easy for these guys to keep on their weight. Take, for instance, Zach Wiegert. He has to eat about 6,500 calories a day. Take a look at what 6,500 calories a day looks like. Now, they work out pretty hard. He comes out to practice every day and burns off a lot of these calories, so he has to do this twice a day. How about that for an appetite, Keith?
Glad I ain't paying for it.
And that's just one guy.
Yeah. This play is in the middle. The power of the fullback, Jeff Makavica, Jr., Brainerd, Nebraska, 210 pounds. He's still growing. 10 minutes and 40 seconds remaining in the first half of play. 12-7 ball game. Nebraska got up to a 12-0 lead at the end of the first quarter. Bruins came right back in their first possession of the second quarter and put 7 on the board. Now Nebraska is knocking on the door again. 2nd and 7 from the 15. Up the middle goes the I-back Childs to close to the 11, maybe the 12, and he runs into London Woodfin, a senior from Sylmar, California. Put the ball at the 12. Make it 3rd down and 3. Ball is back in. number seven. You'll see him at the bottom of your picture. Childs is the eye back. Frazier on the option. Touchdown.
Is this kid quick or what? The tailback goes the opposite direction to hold the middle linebacker, but the center, or the backup center, Humphrey, 51, can't keep up with him. Tommy says, I don't need you this time. I'm going. I see the end zone. He dives in for another touch.
So it's an 18-7 ball game, Nebraska, and let's see what they do here. They're going to go for two. Childs and Makovic are line up. With ball, the wide out. Frazier keeps it. Got it. Walked in. I mean, some fierce blocking going on by that offensive front right now. And it's 20-7 Nebraska with 9:34 to play in the first half. Fireworks show. All of that going on. It was a project of the new athletic director, Bill Byrne. He pulled the money together and corporate sponsors, and they've got Husker Vision now.
And the fans out here deserve it, Keith.
They're great.
They are some of the best.
High kick. Way up in the air. 2 yards deep in the end zone to Brian Adams. Good return by Adams out across the 25, and a penalty flag goes down. He's close to the 30 on the return, but let's see about the flag. It had to do with that stack over there that where Adams got through free and clear.
Illegal push in the back, receiving team.
Happens a lot these days.
As you look at the Bowl Coalition, the top 25 and how they're doing today, everybody is doing all right except Notre Dame at number 9. They are losing to Michigan State. Alabama and UCLA, of course, is losing in this one. BYU, 20, is having some problems.
I expected Arkansas to give Alabama fits today.
Yeah.
That's what they're doing. Right, the penalty will move the football all the way back to the 12-yard line. Sherman Shaw is back in at the I-back position for the Bruins. And now the home folks, their team out 20-7, decide they'll get a little bit involved here, so they make some noise down at that end of the stadium. Wayne Cook, quick drop, quick pop. Kevin Jordan up to the 15. That's a pickup of about 3 yards, and they'll give him the 16 to make it a 4-yard gain. That's Tyrone Williams making the defensive play for Nebraska. Tyrone got hit with a flag a couple of times last week in plays that he really didn't appreciate. He did a whole lot of laurying up and down that field in Lubbock last week. But I thought one of them was very, very marginal.
He probably earned one and didn't deserve the other one.
Yeah, you're probably right. But the law of averages on it. Second down and 5. Sherman Shaw to the 20, and he's a yard and a half short of the first down. Christian Peter, Jr. out of Locust, New Jersey, brought him down. He's one of the two Peter brothers on the Nebraska football team, and he's a vertical leap of 36 inches. That's a lot for a guy that size. Michael J. Fox stars in Teen Wolf tonight on ABC. And then Michael Chiklis, the commish. How come Michael J. Fox doesn't age like the rest of us?
Yeah.
Almost. Shakes a tackler. Shaw with a big play. Out across to the 39-yard line.
It's a big first down and a big run for Sherman Shaw to keep possession for UCLA, not give the ball back. Take a look at 32. That's Stewart. He's going to get under very easily. Gets deep into the backfield. Now the play right there that Shaw makes, avoiding the tackle. I think that was Moss, the strong safety. Big first down to get UCLA out of the hole.
They're trying to respond. Nebraska came right back after that touchdown and put one on the board. That may be a busted play here. The pass is thrown out of bounds, incomplete by Cook. He was getting some pressure from Christian Peter again. In fact, Peter knocked him down. Now he's doing some lorrying, wanting to let the official know that he thought he was being held. And he may have been held. Anyway, the play doesn't work, and it's second down and 10. But I might point out to you, on that particular play, Kevin Jordan was wide open.
Yes, he was. He got for a second, he was open.
Well, they throw him down short of the line of the first down marker, but by only a yard. So on second and 10, they pick up 9.
One of the things that Charlie McBride, the defensive coordinator for Nebraska, wanted to do was put pressure on Cook. And he's had pressure on him the last couple of times. That time he sprinted out to get more time to throw. And still, 41, Ellis, watch him. Just goes right through. It's a linebacker running him down. They're getting good pressure on Cook.
Third and a yard. Washington is in the backfield with Shaw. Third and one, Cook throws it. Oh, he just got enough. Cook, Washington fell down. Cook delivered the ball to him softly so he could catch it. But Darren trying to turn upfield falls at midfield.
Yeah.
Otherwise, he'd have put that ball down around the 40-yard line.
And he was wide open, too.
Yep. So you've had Jordan wide open on the other side twice, and now Washington on this side.
He's going to get out and get open. Here's the man that has to cover it. He gets out real late. Third down play. Get some running room. Tough throw for the quarterback. But he should have hit it.
Put it on the 49-yard line of Nebraska. First down, UCLA. Cook fakes it, keeps it, throws it underneath, and throws it right into the hands of Clint Brown. Short, sharp pass. The intended receiver never touched it. It went right into the red basket of Clint Brown.
This is a fake to the left, and he's going to hit a little pop pass. Now, he doesn't look because Brown is all over the receiver. Clint Brown is the backup inside linebacker. And Brown was ahead of the receiver. Looked like Jordan. And he threw it right to him. He did not look up to see if he was open or not. He just said, well, in practice, it's always open. I'm throwing it.
And off to the fullback, Makavica. And from the Nebraska 49, he travels to the UCLA 43. You've got Damon Binning, 21, in there at the I-back position now. A 20-7 ball game, Nebraska.
Keith, a lot of times, going back to that interception by Cook, you practice it in practice and you throw it, but in a ball game, sometimes it's not the way it was drawn up in practice, and other times you can't see because the linemen are between you and them, so you just throw it blindly, and that's something you cannot do.
Edwards is out on the field again. Donnie Edwards moving around freely, so apparently whatever his problem was, he has overcome it. That is a first down for Nebraska down to the 34-yard line as Jeff Makavica rambles over the left side.
Take a look at number 90. That's Jasper backing up the line. Just slides around and comes back. Gets a piece of it. Probably should have been more up into the hole as a linebacker should be in that hole. But he was a little late getting the tackle, but made the tackle nonetheless. Had 12 tackles last week.
Nebraska offensive front beginning to assert itself, wouldn't you say?
Yes. Yes. Tom Osborne is so good, Keith, as you know, at calling plays. He was a quarterback at Hastings College, an outstanding athlete in his own right. But he calls the plays. He gets a feel of the game. He is his own offensive coordinator. And he just knows what plays need to be called at different times.
Frazier looking toward the corner, and it is incomplete. Intended for Eric Alford, who caught the first touchdown pass of the day. The first touchdown with the pass thrown to over for Nebraska.
Bob Field, the defensive coordinator for UCLA, was talking about Osborne and his play calling. He says it's a grind them up and spit you out type of offense. There's a look at Field. He says, yet they have trick plays, they have misdirection. He says, thank goodness they outlawed the fumble rooski.
And the boomer rooski.
Yeah.
This is Benning. On third down and two, will pick up a first down at the UCLA 22-yard line.
You know, Osborne's been running this offense for so long, Keith. We were chatting with him yesterday. And he just runs it and runs it and runs it. He says, you've probably seen every defense that there is to see. Probably nothing can surprise you that if somebody comes up with something that you think is new, he said, somebody ran that against us about 15, 20 years ago, and this is how we operated against it. And it's a big advantage.
Well, one of the advantages is that play is virtually nothing, maybe a yard for Damon Benning down to the 21, is the coaching staff has such continuity.
That's true.
They've been together for so long.
Staff has been together, and the offense has been the same. Osborne is what? This is his 35th year at Nebraska. He has been on the staff. He was a graduate student assistant for a while, and he's 22 years as the head coach, so things have been pretty much the same around here for a while.
Second down and nine. Frazier. Down the middle, incomplete. This one is off the hands of Eric Olford.
It was an excellent throw, and I think we're going to get roughing the passer.
Flag back up at the 26-yard line.
Personal foul. Roughing the passer.
Frustration setting in a bit.
Yes, yes. This is a play that Frazier scored on earlier in the game about this area. Now, Osborne comes back calling the plays and says, all right, we're not going to run the exact same play as you look at the late hit. We're not going to run the exact same play. We're going to run a play action off of that run play.
Well, that wasn't full of all intent, was it?
It wasn't bad, but
pushed
it was still.
Down.
I'm never going to complain about a quarterback. A roughing the passer quarterback. I'll never complain about one of those.
Got grief. You're supposed to get your britches dirty once in a while. This is Makovica down to the one. Just an offensive line surge, that's all that was.
That's exactly right. It's a good old-fashioned fullback wedge.
Michigan State back to a 10-point edge over Notre Dame in the second quarter.
It's a good time for Michigan State to play them right after a big emotional game.
Over the top, touchdown, Benny.
Is the backup running back, and he's got good spring in his legs, and I think he was already across the goal line before he started jumping. He had that much movement by the offensive front.
Nebraska touchdowns by Alford, Phillips, Frazier, now Benning. Going for two, Frazier on an option. He's got it.
That's the same play they went for two on the last touchdown, but they went it to the left. This time they brought it to the right. They sprint to the sideline. UCLA just outrun UCLA defensively as you look at the touchdown by Bennett.
Nebraska Cornhuskers out to a 28-7 lead in the first half of play with 3:33 remaining. Erstad will kick it off. Only one of his kickoffs have been returned coming into today's ball game, and this is going to go deep enough that it will not be returned. And the UCLA Bruins, who are having a hard time getting good field position for a starting possession, will come out to the 20. Coming up on the Prudential Halftime Report, John Saunders with scores and highlights from all of the games going on about the country. And they'll have a look at Alcorn State Steve McNair, raising the question, can a Division I AA player win the Heisman Trophy?
UCLA 11 rushes 35 yards. Nebraska has rushed 29 times for 229 and three touchdowns.
They work out of the spread now, or out of the shotgun formation. And Wayne Cook will throw, trying to set up a screen for Washington. He's got a lot of room. And Darren Washington goes out of bounds up at the 37-yard line, and you got a Bruin down on the field. Mike Flanagan, the center, took a lick and comes up tender. Big Mike, 281, a junior out of Sacramento.
Here's a look at Washington. He's going to get the screen, but watch the tight end. Interesting what he does. He's going to go in and kind of block the middle linebacker. This ball is thrown behind the line of scrimmage, so you can do this. It's a big difference. You can block downfield if the ball is thrown behind the line of scrimmage.
Ball is given to Sherman Shaw, and Shaw runs it up to the 45. That's a pickup of about 8 yards. Time remaining now 3:10. It's 28-7. UCLA could do with a counter right about this time. Take something to the clubhouse. Nebraska led 12-0 after the first quarter. Cook in his passing so far in the ball game, 9 out of 14 for 142 yards.
The killer was that interception on the last possession that Nebraska took in for a score.
Yeah, it looked like UCLA was moving, and instead he went the other way. Checking off now, the Huskers almost jumped. And this is Shaw popping over the right side, gets the first down, takes a wicked lick from Troy Dumas.
Started at free safety in this game last year against UCLA. And a big hit there. He gained some weight up to 220 pounds. He says the biggest difference in linebacker versus safety is that you move from side to side more and you get to attack a lot and you have to use your hands, whereas a defensive back, you weren't allowed to.
First down, hands. Bruins at the 49. Cook goes big. Nobody there. There is somebody there. It's Tony Veland of Nebraska. So he runs under it unmolested and makes the interception. And that should do in the first half clock.
This is like a curl and go. Watch him pump. He kind of moves his shoulder. He wants the receiver to kind of curl and go, but he reads the coverage differently. That was Jordan. And the only man that was there is Veland. And that's an easy interception. That's where you get the wide receiver and the quarterback on different reads. They have option routes, and if you read one coverage, you run the deep route. Jordan ran it one way, and Cook ran it another.
From the 9, first down, Nebraska, and Phillips is back at I-back. Handed off to Schlesinger, and Corey gets about a yard before Grady Stretz brings him down. Indeed, you got to make a little more room toward the top of your holes, I think, for Penn State. I do indeed.
We've seen, we've done this, 4 weeks now. We've seen Penn State, and they looked awfully good. Nebraska and Penn State looked awfully good.
Second down and 9 from the 10-yard line. Turns it up across the 15 to the 16. So they'll be looking at third and short now. And the clock rolling along at 1:20 to go in the first half. 28-7. And the Bruins, in their last two possessions, have been intercepted.
Cook only threw 4 interceptions all of last year.
16-yard line.
He's thrown four interceptions already this year in 2.5 games.
It's third and three. Frazier finally gave it to Phillips, but it was a bad decision. They're running into the boundary side, and he gave Lawrence no room at all. And the ball simply bounces off of him and bounces out of bounds. And Nebraska now will have to punt the ball away at 43 seconds remaining in the first half. So even the great option people can sometimes make a mistake, can't they? That's why you gang up on him and make him throw the ball, make him pitch it.
They haven't done too many things that have not turned out well here today.
You're right.
They've had this is their sixth possession, and they've scored on four. This is their second punt.
That's still the way you got to play it.
Yeah. Oh, no question.
Simply have to play it.
But you have to stop the run, and UCLA hasn't done that.
Kind of a kick, running Brian Adams all the way back to the 28-yard line. He's looking for some help, gets a little bit back there, and comes back across the 35 to about the 37. So with exactly 30 seconds remaining in the first half, UCLA will have a first down.
J.J. Stokes, the wide receiver, UCLA. He was the Big Ten's Player of the Year last year.
Pac-10,
excuse me. At least it's in the Rose Bowl, right?
Yeah, they play Washington State next week, which will be a tough ball game for them at the Rose Bowl. And that's a conference game. And the objective of UCLA is to win the Pac-10 conference.
That's exactly
the Rose Bowl.
Right.
So they're not going to risk J.J. Stokes.
There's nothing to say that if he would have played, that he would have they would have won this game. Anyway,
and playing on the rug might be particularly damaging to him. Setting up a screen here for Darren Washington, and it doesn't work terribly well because Troy Dumas simply goes around the screen and makes the tackle. And the clock is rolling. Bruins have three timeouts, and finally called one. Stopping the clock with 12 seconds. So they would like to get something on the board before the half ends. Something more, I should say. All the vital numbers are right there in front of you. 12 seconds to play, 28-7 Nebraska. Bruin ball, second down 13 at the 34-yard line on their side of the field. Cook's pass to the sideline to Kevin Jordan. Jordan looking to get out of bounds and finally does, but he's going to be short of the first down. Cook had to throw the ball a long way to get it to Jordan, and they come up a yard or so short of the first down.
UCLA has an outstanding field goal kicker, but they're going to need to get the ball down about another 25 or 30 yards before he can come into play.
Yeah, and he's got to hit it into the wind. And 5 seconds remaining on the clock.
Yard Mert.
It'd take a prodigious play to pick up 25 yards and save anything.
And you get a prodigious play and a penalty.
That helps. There's the beginning of the play right there. Sharmon Shaw does not get out of bounds. Time expires. The half is over. And at halftime, it is Nebraska 28. UCLA Bruins 7.
What jumps out is the turnovers for UCLA. They've had two turnovers that turned into 7 points for Nebraska. They also early on had a punt that was partially blocked that doesn't show up on these stats that led to a touchdown. 47 yards rushing for UCLA and 234 for Nebraska.
Those two turnovers will really hurt, didn't they? Just...
Here's a look at what UCLA did in their possessions. They scored on their third possession on that wide receiver screen. Then they had two interceptions right back-to-back, which really allowed Nebraska to get some separation as far as the scoreboard is concerned with UCLA. For UCLA, Cook was 12 of 18 and had two interceptions and one touchdown. Shaw led the rushers with 53, and Jordan had 116 yards and one touchdown. He had a very productive first half.
And Darren Erstad will kick it off to Brian Adams and Derek Ayers as UCLA will get the ball to start the second half of play. The crowd is 75,687. That is sellout number 196 consecutively. Erstad swings that big left leg into it, knocks it way back into the end zone, and the Bruins will come out for the 20-yard line. Only one of his kicks have been returned coming into the ball game today, and one time the Bruins got a pretty good size return on him today. All right, it's Wayne Cook coming out at quarterback. We'll see who answers the call at the I back. Probably Shaw, though Shaw was pretty well contained in the first half with Ayers and Washington getting some playing time. But it is Sharman Shaw and James Milliner, the setbacks.
There's a look at Shaw, and there's a look at first down and what the teams are doing. Anytime you get over 4 or 5 yards on first down, Nebraska over 7 yards.
Wayne Cook, 12 of 18, as they start with the run. It is Milliner, the junior out of Alexandria, Virginia. And he runs for a first down on the first carry of the second half of play. So the Bruin offensive front moves a change for him. Going with a no huddle now.
The Bruins, Keith, coming out, just have to say, let's just score some points, get some points on the board, and take time off to keep the ball away from the Huskers.
Mike Wynn has only had one ball thrown at him today, and he didn't catch that one. Cook goes the other way to Kevin Jordan, and Jordan is thrown out of bounds, but he's got a first down at the 44. Baron Miles, who almost blocked the first punt of the ball game, made the defensive play. He's the boundary corner.
And he is an outstanding player, Keith. He is very small, only 5'8 and 165 pounds, but he is a player.
Jordan now has 7 catches for 129 yards. And it's first down Bruins at their own 44. Inside to Sharman Shaw, and Shaw will pick up about 8 yards on that carry before the backers bring him down for Nebraska. Linebackers for Nebraska, number 4 is Dumas, number 46 is Coleman, and number 32 is Stewart, with 41 Ellis playing a lot as well, and they are really good.
Well, they're quick, Keith, and this is different from the defenses that Nebraska has had around here in the past. They're lighter, and they're faster, and they attack, and the players like that style.
On second down and 3, lofted down the sidelines to Kevin Jordan, and one of the officials on the side took a hard blow, and he's down on the sidelines.
This is good coverage by Williams. The official will be on to the right side, right there. Now, that's not much, you say, if you're a football player, but if you're a 55-year-old official not expecting it, and you hit your head when you go back on the ground on artificial turf, he could be
seriously hurt.
Could be seriously hurt.
Yep.
Could be a concussion or something.
You see him moving a bit. So we've got a timeout for the injured official. Tomorrow it's a night of season premieres on ABC. First, there's the all-new America's Funniest Home Videos. Then it's On Our Own at its regular time, followed by Lois and Clark. Then the season premiere of ABC's Sunday night movie, Where Are My Children? Tomorrow night on ABC. We are still in a timeout posture for the official involved in a collision with Kevin Jordan and Tyrone Williams on a pass play down the sidelines. He just got trapped. Couldn't get away from the flow of the action and went down very hard. Would it be the line judge, would it?
It would be the side
judge. Yeah.
They usually have 7 officials. They usually have 3 across the back of the defense, one in the outside corners and one in the middle. Now the 2 on the outside corners will move in a little bit to try and pick up. Now the soft spot will be the tight end, because that's the one that usually watches him.
Cook is back on third down and three and throws incomplete. Coverage on the play of Brian Adams, Tony Veland, the free safety. And Veland wins the battle. And the official is up. And I think it's Ron Liebsack who was knocked down, and it is. So Ron has returned to the sideline.
79 is Ogden. He's 320 pounds, blocking on 84. That's Jones. He's 220 pounds. That's 100 pounds less. He's going against 100 pounds, a guy that weighs 100 more pounds and a half a foot taller, but he's got a lot more speed.
Well, that ought to be a penalty. It'll be he ran right into the punter, Shager. He did not touch the ball. That's going to be a UCLA first down when they come back. There are penalty flags all over the field.
Everybody's getting rid of their hanky.
Yeah. But the original foul was running into the kicker. As Christian Peter came flying through there, he did not touch the ball. And you got to come back to the original foul up here on the punt.
The problem with this is, with the first flag on the kicker, UCLA gets a first down. Right. But if UCLA fouled down here, then it's going to offset that.
Okay. So if they decline, push it over here, 15-yard penalty.
Well, you better turn off your referee there, Steve Usek, because they're having their discussion and trying to define the penalty.
They're trying to sort out what they've got, first of all, yep, and then how it's going to play out.
Sounds like it's, you called it, a penalty on UCLA downfield after the foul by Nebraska on the kick.
Yeah.
Also a face mask involved somewhere in there. I heard somebody say that. So here's Steve Usek.
Personal foul, roughing the kicker, okay, here. Then we have illegal block in the back on a return.
So both of those fouls are against Nebraska. Here's the first one. This is, he calls this roughing, so this is an automatic first down for UCLA. There is running into the kicker, which is only a 5-yard penalty, and roughing is an automatic first down, and he called a roughing. So anyway, both penalties were against Nebraska, so UCLA should retain the possession of the ball.
First down, UCLA.
Well, they're not right. Where was the last snap?
Got to find possession and go 15 yards from there. Running
well, that's
into,
right.
Yeah, running into the kicker is much more serious than illegal pushing the back.
You've got to go the other way, guys. Where was the last snap? Snap was on the 49-yard line. The ball is now back on the 46. So how could UCLA, with their kicker rough, lose 3 yards? I don't understand that. They were on the, lose more than that. They were on the Nebraska 49-yard line.
Right.
On fourth down, right? Fourth down and three. Now the ball is back on the UCLA 46. They've gone the wrong way.
Now, the side judge who got hurt a little earlier may have a concussion, but it's got nothing to do with the rest of the crew. We need to get them thinking clearly.
Well, Terry Donahue was talking vigorously to the line judge, and I think maybe they're going to sort it out and get it right, because at this particular point, the ball is not in the correct place.
That's a good guess.
The side judge who was knocked down, Ron Liebsack, he seems to be fine now, and he's back out there on the field.
Good for him.
Yep. It can't be. I mean, the ball's got to come down the other way.
Yeah. This is where, you know, you have a microphone on these officials, Keith. You've got the TV audience and the fans here in the stands waiting. You need to explain what's going on. You've got a microphone. Let everybody know what's going on.
Now, here they go. They finally got it straight. They're going to mark off the penalty. But, the ball was snapped for the punt at the 49-yard line.
It's not a spot foul. You don't mark it off from where it happened. You go back to the line of scrimmage and mark it off.
Well, I don't understand why the ball is on the 46-yard line.
Terry, look at Terry. He's
out. I don't blame him. I'd go all the way to the middle of the field. I heard somebody say face mask. There's been nothing said about that. But roughing the kicker is an automatic first down. And it should be a movement of the ball. I mean, they should acquire some real estate on the play, and now they're finally going to get it.
Now you go from here. Now they got it marked right. That's where the...
Now mark off the...
There middle. You go.
Okay.
Now you're cooking.
Sorry about this. There were a lot of things going on that play. I mean, there were every man on the field threw a flag on something.
Well, yeah, this
ball should be down there on the 34-yard line where it is finally put. And the chains are moved and.
This could slow down an offensive drive right here all this time.
Good, and it's first down, UCLA at the Nebraska 34-yard line.
They got it right.
Yep. And they set up a little screen. The pass is caught by Jim McElroy. And McElroy is inside the 10 for a UCLA first down. Well, it didn't seem to hurt things. Maybe it hurt the Huskers more than it did the Bruins.
The offensive line, wide receiver screen. Watch the line as they're going to let the ball through. Watch him go downfield. Now he's got a wall of offensive linemen. This is the same play they scored on earlier in the ball game.
A lot of freshmen getting a lot of playing time.
First catch of his career.
Yep. First down. Ball is right about the 10. As Cook comes back, gives to Sharmon Shaw. He bolts it inside the 5 and rolls down to about the 3. So again, the UCLA offensive front opens a hole for a running back.
We mentioned at the top of the broadcast that UCLA has a good team and their offensive line is good. They are good pass blockers and run blockers. They can score points. The fact that they only had 7 in the first half was due partly to the fact that they had thrown a couple of interceptions.
Second down from outside the 2. So UCLA comes pounding down the field and puts a touchdown on the board at 12:30 to go in the third quarter.
Well, this is from behind the defense over the offense's left side. That's where Ogden and Christensen are. At Sinkson, the guard that was pulling, there was a nice hole, and Shaw does a nice job of kind of giving it a shoulder, dipping, not giving anybody a clear shot and getting into the end zone.
Burton, off the snap of Anderson, the hold of Walker, kicks it, good. And so with 12 and a half to go in the third quarter, UCLA comes out impressively in the second half. It's a 28-14 ball game. So a big foul on roughing the kicker keeps a UCLA possession alive. The Bruins go down the field and score in their first possession, the opening possession of the second half of play. And we've got a 28-14 ball game. Now Merton is about to kick off to Binning and Childs. And we'll see if the Huskers answer. Nebraska jumped out to a 12-0 lead after the first quarter. UCLA scored to make it 12-7. Nebraska came right back to make it 20-7 and then 28-7, and now it's 28-14. That will be returned by Benny from the 9 to the 31, or maybe 32 or 33 finally when they stop. And let's check in with John Sonny.
Keith, Alabama struggled last week against Vanderbilt, struggling this week against Arkansas, down 6-3. Jay Barker does this himself. About to be sacked, he finds Sherman Williams, who takes it to the races, 73 yards for the touchdown, and Alabama takes the lead, 10-6. That's where they stand now in the fourth quarter. Back to you, Keith.
Thanks, John. I thought that would be kind of rough.
Yep.
Danny Ford will have the Hogs moving around a lot here in the next couple of years. Lawrence Phillips is the eye back. Number one, 200-pound sophomore. Saleh Isaiah made that tackle.
Nebraska scored in the four possessions that they had in the middle. They didn't score on their first or last possession of the first half. Their leading leader, the offensive leaders, Frazier was 4-9 and a touchdown. Phillips had 80 yards on 11 carries and for one touchdown.
Second down and 9. Ball at the 34. Frazier going down the line on the option. Flips it out to Phillips. And Phillips behind the wingback, number 33, Cluster Johnson, had a UCLA corner, and he just kept riding him out of the play. And then all of a sudden, here comes that eye back on that pitch, and he's got a first down.
Keith, it's the tight ends that are doing a nice job for Nebraska of getting inside and sealing off the linebackers and not allowing them to get out and help on that option. They go down the line, and there's one guy out there. There's two Nebraska players, the quarterback and the tailback.
Exactly what happened there.
So look at Shaw. He is an outstanding blocker and has been blocking well all day.
Midfield, first down. This is Phillips, and he loses a yard. Taken down, hit by number 55, Saleh Isaiah, and Donnie Edwards, number 23.
Edwards made that play, Keith. He just closed it down.
Donnie's a bigger guy than you think he is, too. He's 6'3", 260.
He's a smart young man. In high school, in his neighborhood anyway, it wasn't cool, he said, to study or to make good grades. But he knew he needed grades to go to college, so he'd study in private and would keep his report card secret. It was the way it was in high school.
Frazier trying to quarterback draw. Nothing doing. Another loss maybe on the play, certainly no gain, and that will be the third negative play of the ball game for the Nebraska offense.
Edwards was saying that now in college the whole thing is switched around. He says it's cool to have good grades. So he says even if he's going down to the hang out with the boys or watch MTV or whatever, he tells everybody he's going to study because it's cool.
Third and 11. Blitz up the middle, passes away, passes incomplete. Edwards came on the blitz and forced Frazier to unload it. And so the Huskers now will have to punt it. And the Bruins are getting a little mo going here.
Momentum. Bobby Field, the defensive coordinator, coming after Frazier on third down. But the key there is shutting him down on first down.
Yep.
And getting him into some passing situations.
Erstad is in to do the punting. He's had two, 45 and 55. And it's Brian Adams waiting for it. No pressure. High kick. Adams with a clear fair catch call at about his 8-yard line. And there the Bruins will take over with 10:20 to play in the third quarter. 28-14 ball game. Nebraska has the lead. Gorgeous day out on the plains. ABC Sports brought to you by Lexus Luxury Automobile, the result of a relentless pursuit of perfection. And Hitachi. Hitachi makes over 20,000 innovative products. Not a very handsome starting point for a possession for UCLA, down by 14 points. Back on their own 8, in between the 8 and the 9. We'll put it on the 9 since that is the next forward hash mark. You've got James Milliner and Sherman Shaw lined up behind Wayne Cook, and the home folks making some noise down in that end of the end zone of the stadium. And it off to the fullback, Milliner. And he runs it out to about the 14-yard line. And now let's spend a moment with Lynn Swann.
I'm with Mike Utley, who was paralyzed in a football injury while playing with the Detroit Lions. And Mike, I know you're from Washington State, but what brings you to a Nebraska game?
Well, first of all, we're down here with the Madonna Rehab Center, trying to promote rehabilitation, that sort of thing. But also down here at Nebraska, open up a new section for everyone who has a disability or something, kind of hard problem sitting in a real stance, trying to get publicity for it.
Okay, we're going to go to the play with right back.
Cook hands the ball off to Shaw. Shaw will be very close to his first down. Very close. Let's go back to Swann.
Okay. Now, Mike, I know you have a foundation. What's your foundation doing?
Well, right now, first of all, we raise money for spinal cord research. We have something October 15th at Washington State University, and also we have what we call First and Ten. It's a $10 first of each month. That's $120 a year for individuals to get involved. If people want to get involved, they can go 1-800-294-4683.
Okay. Thank you. Keith?
All right, Big Mike. He was a good player.
Oh, yes, he was.
Real bad luck. Strong guy. Third down conversions, 5 out of 8. It's third down and a short yard. Looks like he's got it. Looks like Shaw was able to pick it up. Not all that much, but he got it. Eight minutes and 54 seconds remaining to play in the third quarter. Put the ball on the 20. First and 10 for the Bruins.
Here's a look at Charlie McBride, the defensive coordinator for the Huskers.
Derek Ayers has just checked into the UCLA backfield. He's number 25, and he lines up behind Milliner. Well, they break it up now and go to the spread. Ayers is a pretty good receiver. Wayne Cook's pass is completed to Mike Wynn. But he's just short of his first down at the 29. Now let's check in with John again.
Keith, the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame down 20-7 to Michigan State. But they go to the big back, Lee Becton. Nice move there. Takes it to the end zone. 37 yards for the touchdown. As the Irish are trying to mount a comeback. Down now 20-14. Keith.
John, Greg Ford, he's in the backfield. Quite a story on him. He almost walked on at Nebraska. In fact, he's listed in the Nebraska press guide. Sherman Shaw is absolutely inundated short of the line of scrimmage. I mean, Christian Peter, Terry Corneli, and a wall fell on him. Third down and 12 now as the ball comes back to the 28-yard line.
There's a little bit of a mismatch in size. Woo. Peter, 285, and Shaw, only 190. Look out.
Cook sacked. It's Harris. Wayne Harris makes the defensive play for Nebraska. Cook turned to look to his left, and there was nobody there to protect him.
Well, Harris is over here, and he's just going to come up here. The problem is the linebacker fakes, and the two men on the right side, Shaw 33 and the offensive tackle, they're both looking back at him. A mix-up in the blocking assignments because of the alignment that Nebraska was using.
Shakers punt. Line drive spinner, tail draggers, but going down the field, and he winds up with a pretty good kick out of this. As he rolls inside the 30, all the way down to the 28-yard line of Nebraska. So that turns out to be a 49-yard punt. With 6:18 to play in the third quarter, and the Huskers leading by 14. Washington game, and we did it. It was a night ball game here, and the Washington kids talked about it for months, about how the people of Nebraska applauded them when the game was over. Uh-huh. For a job well done.
Yep.
It's the kind of fans they have here. All right, here's Frazier going down the line on the option. Delivers it out to Phillips, and this time the Bruins defensive pretty well with Donnie Edwards, number 23, over there defending on the play and getting some help from Teddy Lawrence, number 2.
Take a look from behind the offense. You're almost like a tailback. He's going to fake the Schlesinger number 40, and then Schlesinger's going to lead him around. Edwards is number 23, doing a nice job of stringing it out,
Teddy Lawrence right there,
and too. Lawrence. Teddy Lawrence is not very big. He's not going to tackle many of those guys by himself.
Now 15 carries, 102 yards for Phillips. He's got it again. And goes into the stack. Well, he sure got a dandy mark on that. Almost to the 40-yard line. And that'll be a first down. Look at Cornell. They'll be dancing above Cayuga's waters tonight. Penn's been the dominant team in the Ivy for quite a while, a couple, 3 or 4 years. First down, ball is just short of the 40 for Nebraska. Oh. UCLA may have it. They've got it. Donnie Edwards is on the football, and the Bruins make a break, or get a break, as they come up with a loose football.
The center,
Graham, he's hanging his head a little bit like he might have been involved in a mistake.
Look, see if we can see anything on the exchange. And I see when the center steps and goes to his right and the quarterback goes the same way, you're pulling opposite and the ball never gets back that way. When there are certain plays that the center and quarterback know that you have to stay in a second longer to make sure you get the exchange.
All right, if UCLA can stick it in the end zone here, we've got a ball game on the Nebraska 37. First down Bruins. Hand it off to the fullback. And 3 yards.
Second half, Keith, UCLA has gotten a couple of breaks. One, the roughing, the kicker penalty, the punter penalty, that gave him the ball back, and they took it in to score. And now the fumble.
Second down and about 7. It was 3 yards and no dust. Give it to Shaw. He's bouncing outside and makes something out of nothing. Number 84 had a shot at him, but Dante Jones couldn't get a grasp on him. And sure enough, Shaw was able to get around the corner before Leslie Dennis brought him down. And they have marked the ball near the 26. That ought to be a first down, and it is. From Mockingbird Lane on the game. Boy, it's been a hard time for SMU to come back from that death penalty. Darren Washington and Sherman Shaw in the backfield now with Wayne Cook. First down UCLA at the Cornhusker 26. Pass to the sidelines, too high. Brian Adams, the intended receiver, and Eric Stokes, who was is in the backfield in a nickel defense right now, he almost got there too soon. It's legal enough.
Stokes is coming back from a tough hip surgery he had last year. It's been a tough time for him, but making it back. He covered that play pretty well. Stokes, Cook just threw it a little bit late, Keith.
Second down and 10 from the 26. Shaw up the middle. That's a good tough tackle on the 25-yard line. Number 4, Troy Dumas. Senior from Cheyenne, Wyoming. Shaw now with 84 yards on 17 carries.
Big play here.
Complete. Kevin Jordan, no chance. Stokes again making the play for Nebraska. Even if Jordan had made that catch, he would not have had a first down because he would have been in the grasp of Stokes. Timeout, UCLA. Now let's check in with John Saunders.
Well, Keith, as you know, at halftime we posed the question, can Steve McNair win the Heisman Trophy? He's at it again against Alabama State. 29 yards to Tony Bullock. Over 1,000 yards in his first two games passing. Today, 144 through the air and 46 on the ground. Keith.
Yeah, but that ain't Michigan he's playing, is it?
Well, that's the problem, Keith. Anytime you have a, you know, a 1AA player, and we, you know, we talked about it at halftime on the halftime show with Walter Payton, and a lot of guys have come out. They are good, but you always wonder, I mean, how would they do against better competition? And as long as they're playing that kind of competition, I don't think they're going to get the votes.
This will be a 42-yard kick into the wind. Bjorn Merton has not tried today. 5 out of 7. The very first kick of the year was an extra point, and he missed it. He was an All-American last year as a freshman.
That's right. He was outstanding.
So Kevin Walker will put it down on the 32, and it's into the breeze. Not a big win, but there's enough to matter. It's good. No, it's not good. It didn't quite hook back. It kind of got up there and hung and hung and kept turning and kept turning and missed.
Well, if Merton could have made that, that would have been the continuation of some momentum that UCLA has gotten coming out in the second half. But as it is, Nebraska gets a break. Ball just hangs out.
Started to turn right about there and just didn't quite come back. And so UCLA can't cash in the turnover. The Huskers take over the ball at their own 25-yard line. This is Phillips. Donnie Edwards misses him. And finally, he's run off the corner over there by Abdul McCullough. Fella, a 200-pound sophomore from Oceanside, California.
Let me ask you a question, Keith, about the kicker for UCLA.
Yep. What is
Merton, what's he have in common with Herschel Walker, Tony Dorsett, and Marshall Faulk?
Freshman All-American.
Only those four. Those four were the only ones ever to make the AP All-American team. The kicker with three outstanding running backs, huh?
Yep. Second down and one. Phillips going for it, has it. It's McCullough, the man to beat. And I guess he didn't go out of bounds. He went all the way down to the 7-yard line, and that's very poor tackling.
That's Guidry, number 12, bottom right. That's just going to miss the tackle. And now McCullough, the other safety, is going to come over and try and strip the football. He may have stepped out of bounds right there, and the official right in front of him. UCLA both lost both safeties and the two backups. They lost their top four safeties to graduation, but I think he may have been out of bounds.
Clinton Childs is now the eye back. Give it to Corey Schlesinger, the fullback, and the Bruins eat him up. We're lost back to about the 10-yard line. Shane Jesper, number 90 on the hit, big guy from Troop, Texas.
He's made a few tackles today. He's been all over. Certainly looks like from here he's out of bounds. The two officials are right there now.
Looks like he's looking right at his foot.
Can't call that from here, though.
Doesn't matter. It's all its history. Yeah,
that's right.
Put it on the 8-yard line. Second down and goal. Loss on the play of a yard. Tommy Frazier option. Pitch that ball back to Childs. He's in there. Touchdown.
Yeah. this play is watch how quickly he gets rid of the ball. 23 is Edwards. He says, oh, it's going to be a quick one this time. A lot of times he comes down the line, does Frazier. And again, Guidry, number 12, doesn't make the tackle. But Frazier getting rid of the ball very quickly that time, when a lot of the other times he carries it a lot longer.
Point's good. 2:23 to go in the third quarter. 35-14, Nebraska back to a 21-point lead. Well, the sea of red and the occupants thereof feel more comfortable now that their Warriors have gone back to a 21-point lead. At five touchdowns by five different players in your crowd today, as we noted earlier, 75,687. Their 196th straight sellout. Number 200 is going to come when Colorado comes to town October 29.
They're not used to losing around here. They haven't had a... Osborne's been here for 20. This is his 22nd year. He's never had a losing season. In fact, he's never lost more than three games in any season. That is just unbelievable.
Darren Erstad kicks it off for the Huskers and kicks it way back and gone. Here's something about the two coaches now. Tom Osborne got his first win against UCLA in 1973, his 100th win in 1983. And Terry Donahue got his 100th win in 1988 against Nebraska. I mean, what are the odds on that?
Yeah, not very good.
They both had great careers.
And they're both the dean of coaches in their respective conferences. Terry Donahue was the Pac-10 coach of the year last year after leading UCLA to the Rose Bowl. And I'm sure that that's the most important thing on his mind again this year, is getting back and defending the Pac-10 title.
Wayne Cook gets his pass off and it's dropped by Darren Washington coming out of the backfield. Not a very good pass because Wayne was under pressure. He tried to dump it off and Darren had to turn back into the sun and try to catch kind of a floating ball.
You know, Cook has played three games. This is the third game for UCLA, and two of those three he's been out without his favorite receiver, Stokes. Does make a difference.
That play goes up the middle. Pretty good pickup on it, about 7 yards. Next Saturday here on ABC's College Football, these are the games that we are covering. You might want to check around to see which one's in your territory and which ones might be offered on pay-per-view if you have interest in that. I think we got the whole country covered there.
Looks like it, didn't it?
It is third down and four from the 26. That's a first down to Kevin Jordan. He did not have it. He did not have control. Ball got away from him. So Wayne Cook now has hit one of his last one pass in his last eight attempts. And Darren Shager comes on to punt. That's Kareem Moss. Found his way to Lincoln, Nebraska from Spartanburg, South Carolina. Low kick. Break one tackle, you might have some room. Gets it back to the 46-yard line.
Here's a look at a few of the teams that are idle today and the teams that they'll be playing next week. Michigan, Miami, Arizona, and Texas A&M are off. Also Texas, USC, and Washington State, who plays the Bruins next week. Later on tonight, a couple of good ones, Wisconsin and Colorado.
Wisconsin, Colorado really got a chance to be a heck of a ball game, doesn't it?
Everybody seems to be forgetting about Wisconsin.
Jim Boulder. Bill Humphrey is now at center for the Huskers, replacing Aaron Graham. This is Corey Schlesinger to the 41. That's first down. 12 yards, 13 yards, actually.
You look at the offensive line. 66 is Stye, who's going to pull and come and block out on Ward. There's the hole. Tight ends do a nice job blocking too. They just, you know, the offensive line we've been talking about. But, and I know you like tight ends.
Yes, sir.
They do a nice job here. They don't catch many passes. But
they're the blacksmiths.
Worse?
Yep. It's Abdul Muhammad to the 12, 11-yard line. Bruins, for the first time really today, showing signs of weariness now. The defense has been out there a lot.
See if we can pick up the blocks out in front of them. Well, Muhammad wasn't touched till he got downfield, way downfield. That's Wiegert, 72, and Holbein, number seven, and number five, the wide receiver, down about 20 yards, finishing off his block, and the offensive tackle out there staying with their men.
Phillips goes down, ball comes out, call him down.
Keith, that is the thing that is so impressive. You can just tell the discipline that is built into this team, especially this offense. When you see offensive linemen carrying their blocks out, finishing them off, getting their feet out of the hole, following through on their blocks, the wide receivers downfield staying with, the tight ends coming in and walling off the middle linebackers so they can't get around the ends.
Lawrence Phillips now has 19 carries for 178 yards. That is a career high. So he's sort of feasting on the UCLA Bruins, didn't he? Third quarter is over. We'll be back with more after this message and word from our ABC station. Here we go to the final quarter now. Nebraska's trying to put a door slammer on the UCLA Bruins here, leading 35-14. They possess the football, second down and seven at the UCLA 8-yard line. Reggie Ball comes wide to the bottom of your picture. Holbein at the top, he comes in motion. And it's Frazier pitching inside to Brendan Holbein. Touchdown. Cute little play there. We had not seen it.
Is an option in reverse. Holbein, number five, who went in motion, the flanker, is going to come back inside of Frazier. Usually the quarterback is inside. Now the quarterback is outside and throws it back inside to Holbein, the flanker, who reversed and came back this way.
And this is a guy that got creased by a bullet.
Yeah, he seems Stray to bullet. Be all right, doesn't he?
Sixth different player to score. And Tom Seeler hits the extra point. And it's now a 42-14 ball game. Here's Lynn Swan.
Keith, we've been talking about the Nebraska offensive line all day. There are something that's very important to them, and they're pancakes. Pancakes because, not just because they eat them, because they get awards for them. They have a block called a pancake block. If you knock a defensive guy on his back, you make a pancake block, and they get an award for it. Stye and Wiegert are the two guys that won it for the West Virginia game and for the Texas Tech game earlier this year. So when they come out in the ball game, they come out, they really go after the defensive players. That's why you see all these guys on the sweeps trying to get out in front, trying to make the play. Keith?
Can you catch those pancakes?
Yeah, eventually.
Eventually you can, yes. It's a 42-14 ball game. Bright sunshiny day in Lincoln, Nebraska. As the Cornhuskers, who have been around the top of the polls all season long, seem destined to stay there for another week. Here's Erstad's kickoff. It's a high hanger. This one will be returned. Brian Adams out to about the 24-yard line. There, UCLA will have it. And let's see whether or not Terry Donahue is going to give Ryan Feen some playing time. Notre Dame has gone to the lead 21-20. In the game up at East Lansing. Kind of figured that was going to happen, didn't it? Question is whether or not Michigan State can answer.
You know, you don't really know how strong these teams are early in the year.
Nope.
I mean, unless you play some good teams, like UCLA beat Tennessee, that'd give you a pretty good barometer of. I mean, but when they play the easier teams, you don't know what's going on.
Nope.
After about 3 or 4 weeks, then you get a good feeling.
Cook's pass is thrown a little bit behind Kevin Jordan, and he doesn't come up with it. And Cook is on the ground. And maybe hurt. His mouthpiece is out. And he's hanging on right now. So Wayne Cook is down and hurt.
There's
Ryan Feen would be the quarterback to come in. And he's happy with the Bob Toledo, the new
offensive coordinator. It's a little roll to the left. They've run this play a couple of times. May have got a rib. May have got a hit in the rib.
Yep, might have. We've got a timeout. Each other.
He got up and walked off. It may have just been the air was knocked out of him. The breath was knocked out of him. Hopefully that's all. Ryan Feen is in the game.
Fairly probably needs a little playing time anyway. Feen, 6'4", 215, sophomore from Simi Valley, California. I'm very happy with Bob Toledo as the offensive coordinator. Feels it's helped him a little bit. And the pass is completed up to the 32-yard line to Derek Ayers out of the backfield. That's a yard or so short of a first down. So they're looking at third down and one. Feen's a big guy, only a sophomore. He's had his troubles with some injuries himself.
Yes.
But he worked with Toledo this summer on getting a little quicker release of the ball.
In fact, he has a better release than Cook. Cook kind of winds up a little bit. Feen gets rid of it a little bit.
They run it. Oh, I don't know about that one. There in Washington, he just sort of ran into the stack and there was no crack. And they're going to be looking at fourth down, I think. Depends on the snap. Here's Lynn Swan.
Keith, the injury to Cook was just having the wind knocked out of him, but it's a testament to the physicality of this football team. Terry Donahue, when he walked onto the field before the start of the game, he looked at Nebraska and said, God, this is a physically tough football game and team. And you know, when you play a team like this, it's not just what they do to you during the game, it's the effect it has on the team during the week for the next game. They can take so much out of you. Okay?
Fourth down and inches, and the Bruins are going. Why not? They're down 42-14. They only need about a half a foot, and they don't get it. I mean, the penetration was so pronounced, Jared Tomich just came blowing into the backfield, and the loss is all the way back to the 30-yard line. And the Huskers will take over.
Tomich, from the top of your screen, he'll be number 93, comes all the way around. He is the backup defensive end. Nebraska went to the 4-3. They wanted quicker defensive ends, and they got them.
They had so much penetration. There was no chance on that play, was there? Well,
there was no place to go inside, allow the end to come around from the outside and make the play in the backfield.
Clinton Childs is the eye back now, and Tommy Frazier stays in. Boy, he's something.
They can't catch him.
No.
I mean,
that's a first down. At this point in time, though, with 12:50 to play in the game, you're ahead 42-14. I'd be looking for another quarterback, and here he is. Brooke Behringer. Brooke Behringer, 6'4", 210, a junior from Goodland, Kansas. He's in the lineup. Good athlete. Tom talked about him yesterday. So he doesn't lose all that much. He doesn't have the quickness and certainly doesn't have the experience of Tommy Frazier.
Well, we didn't mention it to him, but we kind of ask it in a roundabout way, and that is how good is this kid Behringer? Because if something happens to Tommy Frazier, their national yep. title hopes are out the window.
Yep.
That's not to say that Behringer cannot play. As you look at see what Frazier has done as far as total offense is concerned today. But there is no question that that man right there rides is in the director's seat for a shot at the national championship.
This is Childs on a sweep right. Just short. He's a yard short.
He's a hard-running kid, isn't he?
Yes, he is. When you're listed third on the depth chart, you try a little harder. You don't get a lot of playing time, but he gets the number three guy here at Nebraska gets a heck of a lot more than the three guy at a lot of schools. Maybe the only team that I've seen that would give Nebraska a good game is Penn State.
Yep.
That would be something.
First and goal.
At this point in time of the season.
Yep. Touchdown. He is the seventh different player to score. They have scored seven touchdowns.
Well, from behind the Bruins, the offensive line just going to push him back, and Behringer just getting a crease.
At 11:32 to go in the ball game, if this is successful, it will be a one-sided contest of 49-14. And it is good. And so it's party time in Lincoln. ...49-14 with 11 and a half minutes to play. Jim McElroy and Derek Ayers are the deep people for the kickoff. And Erstad knocks it into the end zone again. Oh, he's coming out. It's Ayers. And how do you do, Mr. Ayers? I'm from Nebraska, and you're down on the 15-yard line. The next for UCLA is Washington State at home, a Pac-10 game. Nebraska does not start their Big 8 conference play for another 3 weeks. They have Pacific. Woo, talk about a demolition derby. And Wyoming coming next.
Uh-huh.
Ryan Feen will be the quarterback now coming out. Spells his name F-I-E-N. Probably is the next quarterback for UCLA when Wayne Cook graduates.
Number three quarterback is Rob Walker, who started five or six, seven games last year.
This is a handoff to Milliner, the fullback. And it works for about 3, maybe 4 yards. On Monday night here on ABC Sports, two of the top running backs in the National Football League will be bumping noggins as Dallas and Detroit get together. What do you like? That's Sanders and
Emmitt Smith.
Emmitt Smith.
Uh-huh.
That's a pretty good matchup.
Those that would be hard. If you asked me to pick, it would be hard for me to take one or the
yep.
other. But
it would.
Emmitt would be tough to pass up.
They're both durable, though. They both play dinged up pretty well. Inside twist, passes away, passes completed to Derek Ayers out of the backfield, and it is good for a first down. Up around the 26-yard line. Nebraska owns all manner of records in the NCAA file cabinet. And these are some of them. At 25 consecutive bowl bids. That's put a lot of coin in the old cash register, hasn't it?
Yes.
Look out across the campus and see the result of it. Screen pass for Washington. And Stokes, number 16, runs him down. Eric Stokes, sophomore free safety, hunting around out there in the secondary in case the white shirt got loose, running around in the open pasture. And suddenly there he was. He went and got it.
You're talking about that Monday night game, Keith, and then I'm looking out here at the UCLA team. It reminds me of a few years back when we were doing UCLA and whomever they were playing, and Troy Aikman was out here doing this stuff for UCLA. What an outstanding player he's turned into be, huh?
Yep. James Christensen has to leave the field with a what appears to be a slight injury. The big junior guard from Fullerton. Mike Rome will replace him, a junior out of Sacramento, number 75. It's first down, UCLA. The ball is at the 47-yard line. Still fighting about it, isn't he? Derek Ayers, sophomore out of Compton. But he does not get back to the line of scrimmage. Skip Hicks is another running back that we probably are not going to see this year. I think they want to try to redshirt him. He's a very, very good running back. And if he does agree to a red shirt, we'll be really hot to trot next year when the season begins.
Yeah, I think he'd probably best be served by sitting out. It's just too quick to come back.
He tore an anterior cruciate ligament long jumping during the spring track season. Second down and 13. Fiends pass. He scooped it, and they give him the catch. It's Avery Anderson. First time we've called Avery's name today. Junior out of Riverside. And he was up at the marker. And they're going to move the chains and call it first down.
Here's a look at a rare species, a true freshman playing the line at the University of Nebraska. That's Grant Wistrom, who was an outstanding player and recruited very much by a lot of big-time schools. And they think he is just going to be an outstanding player.
Bean again goes to that sideline pattern, and did he get his foot down? Yes, he did. He put his foot down at the 27-yard line for a first down. Avery Anderson, 6'2", 195. And what'd they do? Decide no?
Yeah, they brought it back, and I think that's the correct call.
Well, he marked right at it, looked right at it, and marked it.
So here's interesting. Here's a rules technique for you. All right. We can't tell that from here whether he was on the line or not. But the rule in college is if you're pushed out, if you would have come down, you're still out of bounds. So that was I think that was a proper call. Well, may have not caught it either.
That may have been what the official over there was where he marked it.
Yeah.
But he probably couldn't tell both of them, and they waved it off because the following official said he didn't have possession. That must have been the decision. Was he clearly marked him inbound. Now you're looking at third down. There's Skip Hicks. He is a factor when he's in the ball game. He's a good one. Third down and 6. Keen out of the shotgun. Pass is thrown down the middle, and the catch is beyond the marker at the 30-yard line, and that will be a first down. We were talking about ligaments and things like that a while ago. George Sullivan is going to retire at the end of this season as the trainer, the head trainer for the Nebraska Cornhuskers. He's been here 45 years. And what a nice guy. Boy, he has really helped a lot of people. George was among those in the organizing the Trainers Association. Played a big role in the development of that profession. That's a good pass. Delivered right on the numbers. The penalty flag is thrown, and now we're going to stop things. And we're going to have a penalty assessed. The ball is down at the 22, short of a first down. Fien is now 6 out of 7 for 68 yards.
Fien is getting some good work. He is the backup quarterback. If you just joined us, Cook got the wind knocked out of him. Nice throw on a run. A little face mask.
A little knee to the ribs. Gage didn't help things either. Fien, you know, he reminds me a bit of Tommy Maddox. Kind of sidearms that ball, throws it three-quarter at least. Doesn't come popping over the top with it. He gets rid of it quickly. Big fella, he's bigger than Maddox, 6'4". So the Bruins now trying to get another touchdown with 8:20 to play in the final quarter. Ball is handed to Milliner, and he walks into the end zone for a touchdown. Little misdirection and a good seal block on the right corner, and he's got six.
It's a nice drive by UCLA. It's a meaningless score, but you can be sure that the offensive team will take something out of this when they're watching the tapes next week and build on this for their opening Pac-10 game against Washington State.
Well, they started out last year 0-2.
Yep, sure did.
And played in the Rose Bowl.
Yeah, and they had won, what, 10 games since that point, since they lost to Nebraska last year?
Yep.
10 regular season games, it is. Lost to Wisconsin in the Rose Bowl.
Merton for the point. It's good. And the touchdown comes at 8:07 to play in the game. So it's a good outing for Ryan Fien. And you've got a penalty flag on the kick here, so let's see where that points to.
Running into the kicker.
Mark it off on the kickoff.
I think this is going to come from the right side.
He bounced into it.
Yeah.
Healer, we were talking about George Sullivan a while ago. 45 years, going to hang it up. They'll be 69-0 after today. These Cornhuskers will when they have rushed for 400 yards or more in a ball game. But if you can't win running for 400 yards, you're in the wrong profession.
If you run for 400 yards, you ought to win. I love those stats. You see those all the time. Some of those are just so obvious. It's just...
Football always felt a little myth because it always felt that baseball had more stats than they did. Now we're working hard at it. That ball is kicked way back, and it'll come back to the 20-yard line next Saturday. You know, there's a kind of an interesting ball game there with that Washington-Miami game. Arizona took the Washington defense, year before, and went down to Miami and lost by a point, 8-7.
Yep.
And then shut them out 29-0. That particular defense, the way the Huskies play it, didn't cause a team like a Miami a lot of trouble.
They'll put a lot of pressure on the quarterback, and they'll cover the receivers very closely. And Arizona lost a couple of years ago, 8-7. It's the same style of defense, as you said, that Washington.
Brooke Behringer is your quarterback with Damon Binney. Lined up behind him with Jeff McAvica. And it's Binney popping in there. The other running back from Omaha.
Number 21, Damon Binney.
There's a Nebraska for the season. Their run-pass percentage, 55% to 45% today. Here's today, right here. 82% to 18%, Nebraska. UCLA pretty 50-50, but you know, when you don't have to throw, when the running game is working, you know, why throw? And that's where Nebraska was today.
That's a first down on the run by McAvica. So they march the chains up to about the 34-yard line and a first down Husker.
Coming into the game today, Nebraska was averaging 446 yards per game in their first two games, and that average probably won't go down any. It may go up. They were averaging 94 yards passing per game.
Staying on the ground game. 49-21 ball game with Nebraska at 7 minutes to go. Clinton Childs has had a big day for him. Damon Binning playing very well. Lawrence Phillips has had a career day. So the three I-backs have picked up a bunch. At least a quarter mile, if not a half. But it's all made possible by the guys that I admiringly call the Big Uglies. This is Behringer turning the corner. And this guy's 6'4", 210. He's no gimme. But he got around that corner pretty well, didn't he? This is what the Nebraska running has done today. Phillips has 178 yards. Childs has 78. Schlesinger, 50. Makovic, 36. Benning, 21. Frazier, 30. And Muhammad, 31.
And you saw there Behringer running the option. And as Osborne was saying yesterday, he says, we wouldn't change our style of offense if something happened to Frazier. And Behringer went there. He says, there are a couple of options that are designed specifically for the quarterback to carry it that they call when Frazier's in there. They may not do that as often. But Behringer can run the option, as you just saw. And here's a look at Nebraska after today, where they play in UCLA. Keith mentioned Pacific and Wyoming. You look down the schedule, they got Colorado at home on the 29th.
Well, playing down at Manhattan, that's not necessarily a gimme anymore,
yeah,
is it?
That's true. That's true. And they have to go to Oklahoma.
And Colorado comes here.
Yeah.
That's for them. Second down and six. And Benning adds to his totals. He's just a tad short of the first down. And if time permits, we invite you to stay tuned for the Thrifty Car Rental postgame report with scores and highlights from around the country. Their Husker vision in the corners of the stadium that they have here now, and there's some degree of I would imagine common sense being practiced here. You don't want to play too many replays or things like that to inflame a crowd. I'm not sure you could inflame this crowd. They're too smart for that. But there was a very gentle reminder and request about that when the Husker vision went operable today.
We were talking about the pancakes, Keith. That's keeping track of the offensive linemen, and the offensive guys have their stats. I think they ought to do something for the defensive players. Call it a big plays. In other words, keep track. Give them a point for a quarterback sack. Give them a point for an interception, a fumble recovery. If you cause a fumble, if you block a kick or you break up a pass, or you tackle somebody for a loss, give them a point and add up those points and give them something to look forward to.
This is Eric Alford, and a penalty flag goes down at about the 21-yard line. So we sort this penalty out for you.
And that way you would have the defense some way to gauge how many big plays a defensive player has made
illegal
through a season.
Illegal push in the back. Offense.
So that'll bring that play back and wipe out a first down. CFA College Football on ABC Sports has been brought to you by Chevrolet, the cars and trucks 36 million people depend on every day. Genuine Chevrolet. Castrol GTX, engineered for greater protection against breakdown. The U.S. Navy, you and the Navy, full speed ahead. And UPS, the package delivery company more companies count on. It'll be first and about eight. After the spot of the foul penalty. Boy, they're just rambling and rolling and doing pretty much whatever they want right now. It's Brian Schuster, a sophomore fullback, pounding through the right side and then taking off. First down.
This game may not mean much to the fans and the people watching right now, but to the players that are out there, the second and third teamers, and to the coaches that coach these players, this is a very important time to get them some plays, 15, 20, 25 plays in this game, to get them some experience and perhaps play a more important role later on in the season.
It's called season.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. 2.5 minutes to play in that ball game. Notre Dame by a point over Michigan State up at East Lansing, and the Irish have the ball. So it looks like they might pull it out. We are at 3 minutes and 30 seconds to play in this ball game now as the clock rolls along to that point. Second down and eight. The ball is on the 15 for Nebraska. They lead 9. And carrying the ball is number 24, Todd Euler. Euler. Everybody's getting to play today. It's the 10th. Or the 10th different rusher.
Well, these guys go through the same stuff, the same long hours, the same running drills, the lifting, all the other stuff that the stars, the starters do. So it's nice to see that they get some reward by getting in the game and making a block or getting a tackle or getting some playing time.
Scott Davenport is now your eye back, number 17. Scott is the senior. Ryan Schuster gets the call to carry that time, but here's Scott Davenport. There's another penalty flag on the field, senior. You know that he's been to practice after practice. He's taken the lumps and the bumps and the bruises and put up with all of the stuff just for the pure love of the game.
Sure.
Now, all of a sudden, he gets a chance to come out here and run around on the field.
Yeah. Personal foul. Defense.
One area that Nebraska is not deep in, and if they have an injury at the quarterback position, they are in real trouble, because even if it's not Frazier, something would happen to Behringer. They only have two quarterbacks on scholarship. The third, the number three guy, is a walk-on. If something would happen to Frazier or Behringer, they would be down to their last quarterback to go in and make any difference, make anything happen. That may be a problem for him later on in the year.
Todd Euler didn't quite get in.
Especially with the style of offense they run. The ball's in the quarterback's hands so much that he's going to be getting hit a lot.
Well, Monte Cristo, who was the number four quarterback, had knee surgery. And the manager became the number four. Adam Kucera became the number four quarterback. Matt Terman, he's in there right now at quarterback. Trying to wedge it into the end zone with a lonesome train whistle going in the background. And he didn't make it.
What were you telling me about that train whistle the other day?
Oh, sounds down in the middle of Texas. No sound like a train whistle.
Yeah.
Johnny Cash just flashes right up on the wall. Alabama pulls it out at Arkansas. You hear that old train blowing down in West Texas, you just reach for your banjo.
But you said the sound of the train here was second to that one down in Texas,
yes.
Right? I learn something every week in this job.
Matt Thurman is taken down behind the line of scrimmage. Lost back outside the five to the six, hit by Ted Mwoki. The genuine Chevrolet most valuable players of the game are Kevin Jordan of UCLA with 7 catches, 129 yards, and a touchdown. And big old Zach Wiegert from Nebraska. My goodness. Chevrolet donating $1,000 to each school's general scholarship fund to reward outstanding students for their academic achievements and to help those in financial need. Here's Kevin.
Zach is representing the entire offensive line.
Can't give it to the line. I tried to do that once, and they almost ran me off for it.
Yeah.
Zach's the representative. Vershawn Jackson is now in at fullback, and he carried on that last play. And the Bruins stop him,
and
they will take over. Now, this tells you something about Tom Osborne.
I was just going to say that. Just going to say it. A little touch of class there where Tom said, listen, it's all right if you don't score. I mean, you can't tell them not to try and score because they want to get in there. But he put in the number three quarterback at the time, and, you know, that's a little class. I'm running up the screen.
The Dallas Cowboys will be hosting the Detroit Lions on ABC's Monday Night Football as this ball is handed away to Derek Ayers, and Ayers runs around the corner up across the 16-yard line, and the clock now will stop while they move the chains at 52 seconds to play in the game. Only one other team has ever scored 49 points on a Terry Donahue UCLA Bruin team. That would have been USC in 1979. But mind you, this team here today could have done more had they really wanted to.
This is Terry's 19th year at UCLA.
Yep. So. That tells you something about the kind of people he's had playing.
Yep.
And coaching. And certainly he's been the man at the helm.
He's the winningest active coach in the Pac-10 right now, as we
yep.
mentioned. 141 wins.
Well, they started 0-2 last year and went to the Rose Bowl. They won their first two this year. Won them ugly, but they won them.
Mm-hmm. And he probably will get Stokes back next week. Not sure of that because of that, but it's not a knee injury where you're out for the year.
Ayers now will apparently be the man to run out the clock, and the game is over. Your final score is Nebraska 49 and UCLA 21.